Welcome and good evening. Thank you for being here. My name is Dorothea Guillen. I'm the Executive Director for Leadership at CISD. I'm very thankful that the superintendent here is lending me his mic. Our mission at Leadership SAISD is to inform, empower, and inspire civically minded individuals to become leaders within the SAISD community. So thank you very much for being here. I would like to thank my current board of directors. My chair, Victoria Moreno Herrera. My vice president, Annalisa Andrew Rodriguez, our treasurer, Chula Boyle, our secretary, Marta Martinez Flores, David Nungare, Anita Olivia Martin, Romanita Mata Barrera, and Dr. Barbara Taylor. Thank you so much. There are also some special guests here in the audience that I'm very thankful that are here. We have the Honorable John Longoria. And Dr. Mike Flores. I'd also like to quickly thank the following sponsors for this event. First, the City of San Antonio's Department for the Culture and Creative Development. Thank you for letting us use this beautiful space. Thank you, Superintendent Martinez, State Representative Diego Bernal. Thank you, SAISD Foundation and the Rivard Report. And I also like to thank the Amo Beer Company, your parents in the SAISD community. This is the first of quarterly Ed Chats that Leadership SAISD will be hosting. So please sign up on our website to stay connected. Like us on Facebook and share the information that you learned today with your neighbors, your families, and your friends. We also have put around note cards, so while this conversation is going on, please write questions. And we'll be able to answer those questions for you. It is now an honor for me to introduce the Honorable Patty Radel. She is our president of the SAISD School Board. Mrs. Radel is involved in local community organizing, building of community, and being a part of the community. She inspires me every day. And with that, I'd like to welcome Mrs. Radel.
Thank you very much, Dorothea. It's very encouraging to see graduates of the leadership program here tonight. Some of you that I've talked to who are thinking about it, or you've applied but then found you didn't have time to go to classes. I hope you'll keep trying. And it's good as well to see all the support of other people who have been supporting leadership at SAISD. So we're here tonight for a conversation, and we're here with Superintendent Pedro Martinez and Diego Bernal. And we're here because we're all concerned and interested in education. Most particularly, we have some issues coming up on the November ballot. We are going out for a bond for $450 million. And we are going out for a tax ratification election, the result of which could bring in annually over $32 million to the district. To support our buildings, as much as we will have 13 buildings renovated and improved, it doesn't cover all our needs. And the TRV will, the tax ratification election will have a tremendous effect on what we are doing in the classrooms, as well as after school, bringing up our classrooms and our programs and our opportunities for our students to 2016 and beyond. And we are involved in this because of our sense of equality, the right to equality for our students and in a good education, not just within the district, but within the city. And if you travel to the north side and you see their schools, and if you've been in our schools in SAISD, you know that there is not equality. And you also know that the state has abandoned responsibility to helping with that equality. But we, as a school board, and as a superintendent, and as a district as a whole, we are not going to abandon our children. It's our responsibility to try to do whatever we can to make sure that equality happens. And part of that has to be knocking on the door of our legislatures and letting them know how we feel. And we're glad for the bravery of Diego Bernal in being here and having expressed such support for our district. So I believe Mr. Martinez is going to begin, and just as a little bit of introduction, many of you know that he was born in Aguascalientes in Mexico, and at the age of five, his family moved to Chicago, and he was raised there, and he got very involved in education through a very interesting commitment of his mom to the Archdiocese, who had helped their family so much when they came to Chicago. He is the oldest of 12 children, 10 of which are still alive. And he came to us by way of Nevada, where he was a superintendent for the state of Nevada. So that gives you a sense of the respect that he has had in his dealings with superintendency. And we were very, very lucky to have him join us here in San Antonio a year and 4 months ago. And then also with us, again, Diego Bernal, who you've heard a lot either on social media lately or in the newspaper, about the tremendous work he's been doing by visiting schools within his state district and having deep conversations. And the report that he came out with that showed that he did some good talking with the teachers, because so much of what was in the report resonated with what we're seeing in the district. And he is planning on challenging others to take that report in other districts and say, does this resonate? Does this make sense? You know, and then hopefully, next question, can we get together and do something about this? So, with those brief introductions, I'll go ahead and turn it over to Pedro and Diego, who will have a conversation on these issues. Thank you.
So, you know, that usually is, you know, for teachers, there's always on your employment agreement, there's always other duties as assigned. Those are other duties as assigned for yourself.
All right, so just so you guys know, we've done this a couple of times privately. We were kind of rookies in San Antonio at the same time. Him in his position, me in my position as a state representative. What I thought we would do is I want to talk a little bit about, I want to talk about what it was like to come here and to tell us what that was like. And the reason I'm interested, by the way, is that I'm an SAIS guy. I started off in Northeast, and then I ended up at Arnold Elementary, and then at Foy Middle School. I went to Brackenridge High School for a year, got kicked out, and I landed at Jefferson and graduated college. And so, my interest, and this is sort of a guiding question, you've heard this 40,000 times, but let me just tell it to sort of frame what we're doing. My senior year of high school, there was a teacher named Anita Arnold. I was in GT English, and she asked the class, who would like to take or study for a English exam? We all raised our hand, all 20 of us, 32 of us. And then she said, great, I'm so happy and thankful you did that. We're gonna meet before class. We're gonna meet before school. Because Jefferson didn't offer the class, he didn't offer it. And so maybe the first couple times we met, everyone showed up, and as time went on, that number got smaller, and by the time we took the exam, there were five of us. So I was feeling very good about myself getting English Lit credit. I then left Jefferson University of Michigan, where on my first day I learned what email was for the first time, what it was for the first time in class of 95, if you guys wonder. And I encountered a classmate of mine who was from New Jersey, who told me right away that he spent his entire senior year taking nothing but AP courses. So then you take those experiences and you go to my first class, and I realized the people I'm sitting with were smart people, but they weren't any smarter than the friends I still have, but who I went to Jefferson and Bracken and did the photo with. There's no difference. But there's no way that my group of friends or my class could ever compete if they don't have the same class to choose from, they don't have the same opportunity. So that was the moment for me where I became interested in education, because I felt like I had, there was an obligation, maybe even some guilt about being able to do what I was capable of doing, and then other people in the same situation weren't. And there's nothing regarding a meritocracy that explains why we have these issues. So, when he came, I was very excited, because as the time has gone on, as we've been, this might be our sixth or seventh meeting now, he's become increasingly upset. And I like that. I think that's important, because to me, it tells me that his interest here, he's doing it for the right reasons, he's coming from the right place. And so I thought my first question would be, tell me what you thought you were going to encounter, what you had encountered, and what you now believe is the biggest challenge.
Sure. So, you know, I had done my research before, you know, coming to San Antonio, and I knew we were a high poverty district. I also knew this was a dynamic city. So I was, you know, I saw San Antonio, this is one of the fastest growing cities in the country. I felt that, okay, this is a district that is struggling, has a decent graduation rate compared to other districts, but I said, you know, I think, you know, this is a very manageable and frankly, you know, something that can be solved. I will tell you, was motivated with the demographics. I grew up in inner city Chicago. My high school, Benito Juarez. When I look at my old neighborhood, when I go to the west side, when I go to the south side, I get deja vu. When I go to some of our high schools, I get deja vu. It's literally the same type of students, children that I grew up with. Good children, good families that are just trying to do the right thing and frankly just looking for opportunities. So I knew there were some challenges. I think what surprised me the most when I came here is that, I thought I really understood poverty. I grew up in poverty, I just thought I understood it, right? Inner city Chicago, I can tell you the neighborhoods, the blocks in the city. So I thought, I get it. And I was in Nevada for 5 years. Nevada has one of the fastest growing poverty rates in the country. So I thought, I got it. I came here, and at first, it was fascinating to me. Because coming in right now, I have a family of 5 and 2 year olds. And I noticed, you know, as you know, I was looking at homes, and I was looking at where to shop, and where to Costco, everything took me normal. So first it's 81, and I drive up to 81, and I said, my God. Then I go up 87, my God. For some reason, 1604 seems to be the connector of everything. And then when I started driving to the neighborhoods, and Patty, for example, took me to the neighborhoods of the west side, and I saw, literally, blocks that didn't have any sidewalks. I saw, you know, blocks that, when it rained, everything is flooded. Families don't have a place to put their trash. And I thought, my goodness, this is what we fought so hard for in Chicago back in the 70s and 80s. And I really thought, like San Antonio is going to be way ahead of us in Chicago, way ahead of us, because I just felt like San Antonio has a reputation of pioneering so many efforts. And so when I came and saw our district, first I was very sad, because I saw children that had the same struggles that I had when I was a high school student in like Diego. He and I are very similar in age. I thought that by now some of these things would have gotten resolved. I think what, as time got by, the little things that I got angry, is that the more I understood it, and as I went to classrooms, and Dr. Castro was just having this conversation, I look at the working conditions of our staff, I look at the learning conditions of our children, and then I drive by, right, because I have to go shopping. So I thought, where's Costco? Costco's over there by, there's two of them, right? 181, 16, 187. And I passed by some of the other high schools from the other districts. And these are the old high schools. These are not the new ones. These are the old ones.
Right. In our conversations, he keeps bringing up Churchill. That's not a new school.
And I said, my goodness, I thought it was college. I thought it was on community college. I'm like, oh, nobody told about this community college. And then there were our schools. And I have to ask the question. If there were neighborhoods over there by the Dominion, that didn't have sidewalks, that didn't have proper areas to put trash, that overflowed. Would those families stand for it? If they had a school where the classrooms are pre-World War I, ladies and gentlemen, there are air conditioners, there are old radiators that are so loud that they just have to yell for the children to be able to listen. Where the lighting is so bad that you're in the back of the room, like I'm wondering, like how are children even, how can they hear and see what's happening? There's no technology. And in many cases, these classrooms have been like that for years, for decades. And I thought, would somebody in those areas stand for that? So for me, what it really brought out for me was a sense of injustice. And then I started feeling angry because I wanted to, you know, because the first thing you want to say is, how did this happen? Right? And if you've heard me in my community meetings, we show property values and the difference. One of the things that we did, because again, I wanted to learn more, is we actually took our 53,000 students, figured out based on the address that they have and the block they live on, we actually did an analysis of the median income of their families based on the block, the Sept census data. And here's what we learned. So first of all, statewide, our median income is over $60,000. The county is right about the same amount. By the way, if you go to North Central East, median income is well over $60,000. In our district, ladies and gentlemen, the median income is $30,000. We have schools at J.T. Bradford, which is on the west side, median income is under $20,000. Sarah King Elementary School, $20,000. And we don't use it to say to give excuses. What I do is to share with our teachers and I start saying, look, be really sensitive. Because when you're meeting with parents, not only are you the most educated person in that room, most likely, but you're also probably the highest paid person. And that creates a power dynamic that if we don't understand it, if we don't appreciate it, we're not going to be able to reach our children. And for me, Diego, I think, you know, again, it's this, you know, I'm trying to understand, it's like a mystery that I'm trying to understand. And of course, you know, what really gets me angry is when, and San Antonio is a passive aggressive community, you know, people don't say it, but I can tell, because I'm very, you know, I've grown up around this for a long time, I can tell that some families, when they drive by the west side, they drive by the south side, there's a little bit of judgment, right? So they must live like that because they didn't care about education. They must live like that because they're not working hard. Because, you know, they didn't do the right things. And I can't help but push back on that. Because as I look at our children, I see just amazing children. And I'll just give you a couple of data points. We have 10 aggressive goals that we rolled out last summer. And we wanted to be aggressive. And we said, no, we gotta change the conversation. Goals 5 is a graduation rate, 90% by the year 2020. Goal 10, 80% going to college. Including 10% of the tier 1 universities. Diego Bernal is an amazing role model for our community, going to Michigan, a tier 1 university. And one of the things that we saw in our district is that we have half of our children going to college. Well, the majority, and by the way, kindergarten are the gems of our country, and we always say that. But the reality is we had children that were undermatched, right? One of the things that I challenged the trustees, and I think they got sick of me saying this, said, we ask every principal to announce where children intend to go, whether they intend to go to college, what college, whether they intend to go to the workforce, go to the military. And I said, listen to where they're going, but listen to who they are. So listen to the valedictorian. Listen to the salutatorian, right? The number one and number two students in that high school. The students that have National Honor Society. And when you hear, with all due respect, a community college or joining the workforce, you got to ask, what happened? And what happened, right? We have universities, ladies and gentlemen, around the country. They give free tuition if our children get in. And these are like Yale and Stanford. It's MIT. I mean, they're there. And they want our children. They want children from Texas. They want children from San Antonio. And I said, so we're not doing this. So we started challenging ourselves. So this last year, our data is not official yet, but just this last year alone, we're expecting our graduation rate to be close to 85%, up from 80%, the highest ever. And we have the highest college acceptance rate ever. So 70%, including, by the way, 5%, up from 2% of our students getting to Tier 1 University. Ladies and gentlemen, at Jefferson High School, we doubled, still from a low base, from 2 to 4%, the number of students getting to Tier 1 universities. Young Women Leadership Academy, 100% graduation, 100% Tier 1 universities,
half Chihuahua universities, Stanford, Yale, Penn State, Notre Dame. We have schools like this everywhere. The one thing that I'm asking, and Yale is close to your story. So we have Nadia, for example, who's at Yale, who's a valedictorian at Yale Commission Academy. So, and has placement classes. I mean, our teachers did an amazing job to help prepare her. My question is, does she have the armor to survive at Yale? Because if you haven't been to Yale, or Princeton, or Stanford, or Harvard, they're different worlds. They're just different worlds. And I gotta say, ladies and gentlemen, our society is not kind to people in poverty. It is just not. It is just cruel for people in poverty. It is what it is. And I just gotta say, growing up in poverty, growing up where everyone's not appreciated, we probably saw things in Michigan. We see things in some of our top universities here in Texas. It's just not kind to families in poverty. So for me, our goals, the other goals we have, is to build that armor. Because I want our children to be, because I know they're just as smart as anybody else. And I want their armor to be strong. Because when they meet that child, who, by the way, when I was in college, I met somebody who was already 2 years ahead, had 2 years of college credit. And I thought, I gotta compete with this person for job interviews. And that person was taking Japanese. Because they were so far ahead, they could have a double major in Japanese while they were studying the same major I was. And I thought, that's my competition, right? So that armor has to be built up. So for us, when we look at these two ballot questions, the bond was a no-brainer. 12 or 13 projects have not had work in those main buildings since the 1968 bond. One of them had a little bit of work done in the 1980s bond. I will tell you, we did a poll, the community, you know, the board and the district did a good job with the 2010 bond. You know, basically they said after that 2010 bond, said we need at least two more to finish up the work. People were expecting it. The only challenge I have on the 2010 on the bond is the buildings that are not part of the bond. There's so many individuals. They said, what about YWLA? What about Holly Garden? What about Highland Hills? What about, I mean, I can go on and on with them because there's so many buildings that need. When we started looking at the tax ratification plan, this is another piece where I got to be angry about. So, you know, one of the questions that I get is, well, you know, Pedro, property values are rising in this community. Like, we're paying property taxes, right? And by the way, anybody here who lives in the Jefferson area, the Edison area, King William, La Vaca, South Town, I know you can't afford it. Trust me, I know. But, you know, one of the things that I tell our businesses and I tell our residents, when you go around the state, if you ever get a chance to be like in a rural part of the state, maybe in a not urban city in the state, make sure that when you meet people that they thank you. Because when property values rise here in San Antonio, that money gets redistributed statewide. So the way education is funded in our state, we're funded by formulas. So when we get an additional dollar property wealth, it's immediately deducted in state revenue. And that money is redistributed. So because we have other parts of the state that are denied, that their property wealth doesn't grow as much. And so that's how they balance it. There's no free lunch, everybody. You have to pay for education one way or the other. In many states, it's a combination of sales taxes, income taxes, and property taxes. Here, after the tax, it's all property taxes. And our formulas, now I wouldn't be wrong if the formulas have been fair, our formulas have not been adjusted in many cases more than a decade. We get a 20% increase above the normal formula for students that are English language learners, that are children living in poverty. Do this research, it's public everywhere. Look at how much it costs to serve a child who either has English as a second language, who is a special needs child, who lives in poverty. It's at least double or triple what it costs a general ed child. That's 93% of our students. 93%. We have the highest poverty rate in the country, in the state. What's interesting is there's one district that I found that had a higher poverty rate than we did, and that was Brownsville with 94%. I mean, I love 10. I mean, that was the only district that I found that had a higher than we did. And by the way, we have the poorest zip codes in the entire county. So we had one chance, and that was the lawsuit that the districts put in place. All of the districts were waiting for, you know, literally it was waiting to make a decision. Everybody was hoping that it was going to be positive. Then we get a Supreme Court decision saying, hey, these formulas, they need to be updated, they're outdated, they're not sufficient, but it's not our job to fix that. It is the legislature. Immediately, and Representative Bernal will tell you this, immediately, you heard from him, Senator Menendez, all of our legislators said, you lost your opportunity for any changes in funding. And in fact, just recently, Lieutenant Governor came out and said, basically,
hey, oil prices are down, surprise, we don't have enough money, so pretty much people are cheap if you get what you get. So that's it. So that's the end. So that's the end.
That's all right.
That's the end. That's right. I want to take three topics to go through with these questions. The first is, when you hear this a lot in education circles, especially outside of here, and that is about managing expectations when you've got a very poor population. Oh, you've got a bunch of poor kids in your district. They're impossible to get to the same level as kids, say, in other parts of the state right now. So do what you can, but don't expect the same kind of achievement. And a lot of what you said, I think, is on the face of that notion. So I want you, for a second, to talk about, or longer than a second, if you want, to talk about your belief in the sort of innate ability of all these kids to achieve. And then I mean, I'm just for you guys too, I'm going to ask you about the bomb.
So, you know, President Rago says this in the past, and she says this everywhere now. She said, our children have the same amount of brain matter as any other child in the state, in the country. It really is about us giving them those opportunities, and of course, empowering our teachers to do that. And I have proof of this, right? So, I share with you some of the data on graduation, college rates. Here's an interesting one. So algebra by eighth grade is a big deal because if we can get children in pre-calculus, calculus by senior year, math is one of the biggest gatekeepers in college. And so we challenged our middle schools last year. Our middle schools struggle. I mean, they just struggle. They're our weakest level. They struggle. And we said, across the board, we want to increase the number of children in algebra by eighth grade by, and we set a target district-wide of 40%. So we went from 500 students to almost a little over 700 students in algebra. We got some pushback because teachers said, hey, they're not going to be ready. We said, no. I mean, look at the students, look at where they're at. Who can you push? Who do you think will be ready? So with the 500 students the year before, we had over 97% of them were proficient and over 40% of them were advanced. So not only did they meet the standard, they were advanced. I mean, these are students that should be on a track for calculus by senior year, and frankly, should be on track to be engineers. I mean, that's the way I really look at it. And so we went up to, you know, to a little over 700, almost 740. So here are the results, everybody. Proficiency rate, 97%. Advanced rate, 40%. Keep in mind, with more students. And then we did the same thing with ELA, with smaller numbers, but we also bumped by 40% and had similar results. And so for me, it was a proof point. Of course, the numbers are going to be higher than this year. It was a proof point to our middle schools, A, that they could do it, right? If they have the ability if we support them, they can really see those results for their children. And it was a proof point for our children. And I'll tell you, my goal and my mission is becoming, we've got to change the conversation in our community. Because for so many years, and I tell this before, expect more from us. Because for so many years, we've allowed ourselves to have this pobrecito mentality. Oh, pobrecito Diego, have you seen his growing up? Have you been to his home? You know how many times he's moved in the last 3 years on the apartments? He's had a move. We have over 1,000 children that are homeless. They're homeless. And that number's growing very fast. So that pobrecito mentality exists, and we've got to challenge that. Because, ladies and gentlemen, the only true thing, right research that really helps people out of poverty. There's other things that help, but to get them out is through a quality education and helping them have those opportunities. Going to higher ed, getting them some kind of career. Those are it. There's other things that can help, but I'll tell you, that is the main solution. I mean, that's what I saw in my personal life. I'm pretty sure there's many examples here in the audience.
So on the bond, one of the things that really surprised people, I think the Supreme Court decision or not decision, notwithstanding, was you've been here in this position for 5 minutes, right? Just for a second. It hasn't been very long at all. And already you've got a bond proposal and a QA proposal. Explain why you felt you had to do that now, considering how new you are, versus I think a lot of us are used to things in the same team for a very long time, a long tee up. Let's have a community conversation, which is really, you know, let's get people to talk about it and forget about it, so we don't have to do it. It's my experience. But you jumped into this right away. I think that's sort of daring for something so new. Tell us why you decided to do it so quickly after a while.
So I got to first start that myself and our board, we're a team of eight. So we all saw the same sense of urgency, because I depend a lot on our trustees to give me guidance, because they know the community. So we talk about this. In fact, we had several meetings, including private closed sessions, talking about the challenge we have in our district. We started ratcheting up accountability last year. I won't tell you the numbers of new principals that we have on campuses. It's not a small number. Many of them were by design. And I'm still fighting some of those battles now about defending some of those decisions, and I have our data, and I can easily show it's happening, right? Because, and so we're holding staff accountable more than ever. If you talk to our teachers, and I'll tell you, our teachers are working so hard, they are feeling so pressured, right? And my thing that's keeping me awake right now is they feel overwhelmed, because we're putting so much, again, and it's not, we're not asking them to work longer hours, but we're asking them to be more strategic, to think differently, and that is hard for them, because they weren't allowed to do that. So now we're pushing them to be out of their comfort zone, and that is hard. And I said to Diego, if we're going to be doing all this, and here I am, going into these buildings, seeing these learning conditions, seeing the fact that we're struggling to put in, you know, strong after-school programs. We had summer programs that were a week long, and they were required by the state because it was for children that either failed or couldn't pass a state assessment. Nothing of enrichment. Right? Here I'm pushing more children to be in algebra, more children to be in advanced placement classes. We're setting these aggressive goals. I said, you know, are we really being fair? And this is what, you know, the trustees and I spoke. Are we really being fair to our staff? Because we're definitely holding people accountable. And I will tell you, talk to anybody in our district, some may like it, some may not, but it is there. That there's a non-negotiable there. But is it fair if they don't have the support and the resources? And then when the Supreme Court decision came down, That was the one thing I said, maybe I'm lucky, right? Maybe, you know, I've always felt blessed. I said, maybe there's an angel, you know, when my sisters have passed away, I'm sure she looks over me, you know, maybe there's an angel looking over me, and maybe we're gonna get this positive Supreme Court decision, and oh my God, you know, we're gonna have all these additional resources. And then what angered me, I found out that the last legislative session, the state had $6 billion with a B that they didn't. They said, you know, session's over, we don't have time to budget for it, we're just gonna put it on the side. $6 billion with a B, ladies and gentlemen. And I said, who does that? Who does that? So I felt compelled. Again, going back to equity. Going back to social justice, we are determined to transform our district. I felt compelled that we needed to do this. And at a minimum, even if we don't succeed in November, and just like today, we got to have a conversation. We have to have a conversation, because if we're not having a conversation, ladies and gentlemen, it's not fair to our families, it's not fair to our children. These inequities have been created over decades. In fact, we're going to have an event in which Dr. Christine Brennan, I don't know if anybody has ever seen her presentation, she talks about the history of the city of San Antonio and school districts and the systemic inequities that got created over decades. It's a very factual presentation. It's very factual. We're actually going to have host a community event along with leadership at SISD and our foundation that we'll be announcing soon to actually have that conversation publicly. So for me, we felt we needed both the tax ratification election, another reason that it's so compelling, and yet we always describe as the best. Our bonds, they will help our facilities. The tax ratification election, ladies and gentlemen, will help our program, our enhancements. Imagine Jefferson High School, who is now going to be an international baccalaureate high school. We'll be able to design that building, as beautiful as it is, and restoring it with an international baccalaureate frame of mind, right? But then we'll also have the resources with the TRE to put in the programmatic enhancements. Because we know that if children graduate with an IB diploma, and we've had a small group graduate every year from Burbank, those children have the best chance to get into top colleges. And Burbank has had a consistent, because it's the most consistent of all of our schools in getting students to Taylor universities. Most consistent, if you look at it over a decade. Why? Because they're IB diploma children. But they need additional support, particularly in classes, they need some of them need extra support after school, teachers are working longer hours to make sure the children are prepared. These are the resources that are required.
I'm gonna slow you down for a quick second. Let's go to the bottom. I think that a lot of folks believe that, say, the barns for buildings, they're looking at the outside of the building, they're seeing a building just school. And in their mind, they think that what we're saying, that we need to just modernize the building. And I'm not sure that they quite understand the necessity, the dynamism of the situation, and why this bond is necessary to change the building. So I want you to describe what that would mean, it looks like. Obviously, it's not just modernizing the building. It's not taking something old and polishing it. It's not really just a code. It's not just what we need.
So I'll just give you an example of Jefferson. So which you told me before, and
so this shop. So we have our curriculum folks going out to the schools and working with teachers. So we have our math and science curriculum director go out, and he's sharing with me, he's from Rice University. He's sharing with me that he walked into the science labs at Jefferson High School, and many of them have not had running water for more than a decade. And he says, so basically, the children have to go to other rooms when they're doing experiments. They lose a lot of instructional time. And he was shocked. He said, and he asked his staff, he said, how long has this been going on? He said, over a decade. And I said, well, you know, can somebody fix it? And of course, call facilities right away. He said, it's very expensive to fix. This would be a seven-figure to fix, because it's not as simple as fixing some plumbing in the afternoon. Because, again, it's a very complicated building. And so, for us, you know, the systems are outdated. We want to, it's not just about fixing the building, it's having the learning conditions. And like I said, for me, and tying it to our strategies around academics, Jefferson has to look like an international library in high school. Imagine with the history that we have there, we have Nobel Prize winners, two of them, that have come out of Jefferson High School. Imagine the opportunity we'll have to connect the alumni and that kind of rigorous curriculum if we have both facility that meets those learning requirements as well as the dollars we are funding programmatic needs that it has.
It was a story that you told me that it had to do with an old air conditioner. And the air conditioner was so old that the company that manufactured the air conditioner doesn't exist anymore. They don't exist. So there are a couple of employees whose job is to manufacture or fabricate parts for this air conditioner because that's the only place that you get.
And we have to literally try one and then go back, adjust it to another because these systems are so old, nobody needs the parts anymore. And I've stressed that we have to renew ourselves.
And so, my question all the time is how are our students, we've already established the same innate capabilities and abilities, how are we supposed to compete when things are so disproportionately often wrong? It is an injustice. I'm going to ask you about the TRE. But then I am going to ask a question on
campus. Sure.
Because where I really sort of fell for this man was over Bacchus on Fredericksburg, and he asked the question sort of rhetorically, it was, how could we let this happen? And I think that is an important question. When you listen to what he's saying, he's not just talking about our school, he's also talking about our city, about infrastructure. He stays asking the question that we should all be asking all the time. So let's go to the TRE. And when I talked to you guys and other folks, I've said exactly the bond is for buildings, the TRE is for education. And people are looking for a place to live, shopping around town, moving town. They're shopping for school for their kids. Yes. And their main measure is what's happening inside of those classrooms bell to bell. We'll get to the extracurricular and enrichment stuff in a second. But let's talk for a second about what happens in the school, bell to bell, and how the TRE would change that.
So the best vision I have for you, we just opened up a brand new school. We did it in partnership with foundations that had not given us money before, and even to other institutions, because they started giving us resources. We partnered with Trinity, which is the top university, not only here, but one of the top in the nation in certification. And it's called the Advanced Learning Academy, and I'll tell you, we have now, in these classrooms, we've empowered teachers to develop custom curriculum. There's no bell times. So if a child, if they're into a project and they need to work an extra 40 minutes, they just do it. When they have a little block called genius time, where children, whatever their strength is, whether it's writing, whether it's science or math, they spend that block of time just doing that. And they're advanced. So even though you might have grades, they're advanced. So K-3 is a band. So if you have a kindergartner who's advanced in math, he'll go to a first grade classroom and could be with first grade students. And vice versa, by the way, if somebody's struggling, it's all working teams. So, you know, that's between the two buildings of Boston Academy and Fox Tech. We've never had more than 500 students. Never more than 500 students in the last 5 years. We now have, ladies and gentlemen, over 1,000 students. By the time this program is fully developed, it includes the existing Fox Tech programs. We'll have 2,000 students. We have families coming from everywhere. The Austin Academy, which has never had more than 180 students who were oversubscribed in kindergarten, first grade, and this is a K-3 building in pre-K next year. We're already scared, Diego, of what's going to happen in the future. Then we're going to have our STEM high school in partnership with HEB that's also going to be on that campus in two shot buildings. So when I look at that programming, then I say, okay, we're ahead of where we see as future development there. But let's go to the east side, right? In the east side, here we have on the bottom, we have Sam Houston, and we have Davis Middle School, both on the ballot question. Right? Here's St. Philip's. Imagine with all these resources what we could do in creating an innovative program, pre-K-12, most of the campuses with St. Philip's. We already have the Innovation Academy, which we're moving to Wheaton. And we want to make sure we enhance those programs. We're talking to the principal about expanding to 12th grade. By the way, it's first year, 4th to 6th grade, already one of our top 3 schools in every subject in our district. Those same goals were struggling in other places in our system. So what the TRE is going to do, you know, is it's going to allow us to take some of these very innovative ideas, whether it's IBA Jefferson, whether it's innovative ideas on the east side. On the west side, we have the FOIA, Irving, and Lanier. They're all part of the bond. When you connect them with the TRE, JT Breck, which is one of our oldest elementary schools, we can do some innovative things. And I believe, ladies and gentlemen, we can, again, this will help us to transform our district.
I'd like to ask about Lanier. So I got the signal that we're out of time for this part. I think this is the moment we can take questions.
Yes. I have a question. In going back to the TRE, that's probably the most important that everybody can get with both of their two-fit and degrees. Can you explain a little bit about the state science, what they'll do?
Sure. So here's the beauty about the TRE. So first of all, there's a couple of things you need to know. It's already reflected in the taxes now. So when the board voted on August 15th to pass or go for the TRE, immediately that tax went into effect and it's already in your total bills. So just know that it's a 13-cent tax, it's already in your bills, so it's not an additional tax, and then the bond will be phased in over 5 years. So you wouldn't see the bond, that impact, literally until a year or two from now, and then be phased in slowly. But the 13 cents is in there. What's beautiful, what's great about the TRE, the state said, look, we're not going to just inform us, but if you're willing to help yourself, we will match whatever you raise, dollar for dollar. So we can raise from our taxpayers $15.6 million, the state matches it with another $16 million. And it doesn't go away from us. And unless we become a very wealthy district, we don't need that many states involved with the state students.
So just to make that point again, right now, as I said before, here today, the state will collect money from the district, bring it back to Austin, and then redistribute it around the state. This is literally the first time where your money is also like taking that money and walking it over to the neighborhoods. It's the first time that we are not going to keep the money that we generate locally.
And it's matched by the state.
That's right. And then for that problem, the state comes in and adds. It's actually a little bit more than that.
Yeah.
So we've never had that before. We've been sort of swimming in that sea of water that's created by the state industry network. This is the first time where your money goes directly to your neighborhood school, and the state comes in and gives you a little bit more than a dollar match.
And everybody, again, the 13 cents is already reflected in your taxes. So that's one of the things that is going to be confusing for taxpayers. You'll already see it. So that's what's called ratification. So a vote for that will ratify the tax. If it's voted against, then bills will have to be done and that will potentially come out.
All right. Other questions?
I think when we talk about this bond program, what we really need to do is it's got to be messy. It can't be what Victoria was saying, if you're coming back to another bond and we're in for tax increase. What we're asking is our community to make an investment in ourselves. With that, I wanted to say I'm with the Desi Lamedo with the Texas Association for Bilingual Education. Dual language is by far the most successful program. Statewide passage of STARS at 77%, but for the dual language kids, it's already at 65 and climbing, so we're closing that achievement gap. Dallas has had dual language for the past 11 years. English, Houston ISD, which used to be English only, failed so miserably that district-wide their dual language. Dallas is district-wide. Far San Juan, Alamo in the Valley have been district-wide for years. I know that there's plans to expand dual language. Would you be in support of expanding dual language district-wide in San Antonio ISD?
Yeah. So the short answer is yes. In fact, you know, one of the things that I was very, very proud of is we were able to bring Dr. Liga Hernandez, who was the person responsible for the expansion of dual language in Austin. That, by the way, Austin ISD is the largest dual language program in the country. The largest in the country. Over 50 elementary schools and growing that provide dual language and go all the way to high school.
Yep.
And she was the person responsible for it. So she's already developing a 5-year plan. We're actually going to have a dual language summit because we want to really help our community understand the benefits of dual language. So that'll be coming in the next month. So wait for that announcement. And then we're going to make an announcement about at least one school that you're going to hear about that's being transformed to a dual language academy as early as fall 17.
And then anecdotally, some of you may have read and Patty mentioned earlier that I visited all these different campuses in my house. She has campuses from Northside, Northeast, and SCIS. And one of the things is, there's a section in the report that says, for the schools and the educators that work in dual language programs, they swear by it. It's like a cult. It's like a religion. They say it's the best thing that ever.
Because it works.
And not only because you've got monolingual language speakers speaking the other language, but everybody's science scores would go up and their math scores go up. So people who live it and work it swear by it. It's something you have to live for it. So it sounds like you're on it.
Thank you. But they're amazing work because to keep the facilities, the new facilities are clean folks. They're well taken care of. But they're just old and they just have systems that haven't been updated. So the savings we see, we're going to invest it right back into our academics.
So and that's why they can go, they can stay at the school.
Absolutely, into the school. And what I want you to envision, and I want you to hold us to this, talking about accountability. Because I get this question, if these resources are passed, how are we going to hold you accountable and make sure they're used well? So first of all, we have our 10 goals that were very transparent and we have a report card for us. But the other one, I want you to expect and use the Advanced Training Academy, the Leadership Academy as examples, the Women Leadership Academy. What our plan is to take each of our schools and make them innovative and provide programming that frankly, because our children have different needs, there's different needs in motivating. And I use the Foster campus. We're going to have a STEM high school that's focused on technology. The Advanced Learning Academy is focused on the humanities, and the arts are very integrated. So it's almost like a college campus where you can say, hey, I love the humanities. My wife is a liberal arts major. She loves liberal arts, right? That's she's an amazing writer. That's just who she is. So there's something for somebody like her. But then there's other students who love technology, right? Computer programming, computer science, cybersecurity. And so for us, and I said it at a school, we have the Jefferson Community Lab, the biggest international laboratory program in the county. So in that itself, we get into an amazing program. We're looking at Sam Houston and Davis. Again, what can we do there around STEM, especially connected to St. Phillips? So for us, well, we want to take these resources, whether it's building resources or the TRE, and put them together and create some magic with that. Because I believe in this fast-growing city, that is going to bring back our families. And the Advanced Training Academy is one of the best examples I have for that. It's in its first year, ladies and gentlemen, barely over 2 months. And I would ask anybody, go see what's going on there. You will fall in love with the school.
So I have a question. I'm a graduate from SAIC, kinder through senior high school. And I can't help but look back and think like, wow, what would the trajectory of my life have been if I had been able to participate in any of these innovative programs that we're talking about? Now, as a parent, I'm a parent of a child who has several learning disabilities. In participating in the Blue Ribbon Task Force, it was so heartbreaking to see the conditions of our special education classes. So where in this roadmap does the innovation for children who need life skills, or children who are great candidates for being in a general education classroom, but need different and innovative ways of classroom curriculum? I don't see that in any of the conversations that we're having. Why?
It's a great question. So it's definitely, especially the big part of our initiative. So I'll give you an example. So David Hill School, who's one of the most neediest facilities. I'm going to say one of the most unattractive facilities we have.
Which I went there, but it looks exactly the way it did with my last year.
Yes. So Davis Middle School, it was a low performing, it was one of our lowest performing middle schools last year. We have an amazing principal there, Mr. Garcia. Turned around in 1 year, came out from an improvement required for campus, now has a distinction in science. They more than doubled the math course. What I love was the story that I published. So the east side tends to have a large percentage of special ed students in addition. And what I love was we put in technology, project-based learning. And one of the things that I heard, this was really something that was really hard to develop, really hard for me, is that I had special ed parents that came to us and said, I never thought that our children could do this type of work. And then we did technology, we worked in teams, it was project-based, by the way, which was self-contained classrooms, as well as children that were coming into general classrooms. And so when I saw the example of Davis, this is in the east side, right? Second course there, zip code in our district. And I saw children with a high percentage of, already in middle school, a special ed student, and I saw the success. Immediately I told our staff, we got to get them. So as we modernize our classrooms, in fact, one of the first things I'm looking at is, let's prioritize special ed classrooms. Why? Because we know the best, and this is for all our children, right? But really for special ed, it has to be their inclusion. It has to be. So that we can really take their skill set and build them up. I will tell you, technology today has the power to help us do that. The sad thing is, you see that classrooms, Davis, the reason they were able to do that was because they got a grant from the state to go to a performance school, and they invested in training teachers in this type of curriculum, project-based learning, they invested in technology, and did that. Imagine if we could do that, and this is what $1 million, but that's how much it costs. Imagine if you could do that with online campuses in every special ed classroom. And they did it in every classroom. But special ed, I mean, just like I said, the reaction I got from parents. So just know, special ed will be a priority, and we're looking at models like Davis to guide us. Doesn't mean we have all the answers, but we gotta work with parents on this.
And just for the benefit of the audience, for a lot of our SAIC families, it's through the public education school system and through their middle schools and high schools where their children have the only opportunity to learn those life skills. They don't have the benefit of having financial resources to be able to send their children to or have, you know, specialized instruction at home that will teach children how to have autism, you know, self-care techniques. I'm very lucky that I work for a corporation and that my son's needs aren't that exacerbated, but you know, we as a family are struggling in the classroom. And it's very important for families like ours and families who aren't able to advocate that we keep pushing for innovation in special education.
And please expect more.
And that's that point, just listening to you, I think that that's a good example of the way that the bond theory works together. I think you described the bond alone becomes harvest, but not all of the theory becomes harvest, but not all of them together. I think they would be able to be able to.
So I want to thank you both.
So, right, there's an election coming up, and I'll let me be the guy who does a great job today. But being that I am in the position I am, I can certainly take this moment to ask you guys, please, to vote yes and vote for the ballot issues. But we have to ask you, when in your life have you ever had the opportunity to vote on a social justice or equity issue? We vote for never had the opportunity, and this is one of them. And so that's how strongly I feel about this. The reason why I ask the questions that I ask is that I want people to understand not what we're trying to do, but what it means on the ground in application, the way it can change students' lives and their trajectories, their families. That is what we're voting on. And so I want to thank you for your time and for your candor and for your passion for being here. You know, as far as I'm concerned, you're a good boy now. But also, I want to make sure that I take the moment to make the pitch and the thing you guys on election day. You go in very, very far to make sure you vote yes and vote for
this. Take your friends, your family, your neighbors.
On behalf of leadership of CISC, I want to thank you, Superintendent. Our board president, thank you so much. Thank you for being here.
I apologize, I'm going to run, but we have literally another committee event tonight at Edison. Is anybody who wants to come and hear this message again? So we're having 7 community meetings. It's so important for us to get our information out to our voters, to our parents. And so just know this is the first of 7 that we're doing tonight is Edison. So that's where we're running to tonight. Thank you.